Hi guys, on this show we're looking at Preston, Marin, Savini, Hayek, Lewis, Keitel, Tarantino and Clooney. We're looking at 1996's From Dusk Till Dawn.
Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of 100 Things We've Learned From Film. I'm one of your hosts, my name's Planty, and plants don't talk.
And I'm the other gringo, and I do talk a lot.
Boy, don't we both. Juan, how are you?
Son? I thought you were going to say Juan. Juan.
Juan.
Juan. Juan Sheets Plenty. I'm good, mate. I'm good. How are you? How's things? You're just back for holidays.
Back so. from the Cape of Verdes. Yeah, it was good, mate. It was nice and warm. It's fantastic. I got some films watched. It was really good. Finally got round to watching Nope and really wished I hadn't watched it on the iPad. Wished I'd watched it on the big fucking telly.
Aye.
So we're going to watch it again this week on the big telly. Yeah. That's a fucking beautiful film, by the way.
Aye, but it's all shades of... What? That's a noise. I watch it on the big telly.
We're going to watch it on the big telly this weekend. Anyway, cool. We, of course, on the podcast, tries to learn 100 things from a film every week. If you like what we do, you can join us on the socials. But you can also give us a pound and we will give you a shout out at the end of every episode. For just £1 a month, we'll also give you some episodes of things that are happening. So there was a nice bonus episode of Facts and Lies and Rock and Roll for listeners this week, as well as the standard Facts and Lies and Rock and Roll that we do when we can't be arsed or when we're busy. But yeah, John, this week we are talking about Alouette.
1996 sounds like years ago, but it was. From Dusk Till Dawn.
Wow. Right, it's our first Tarantino, kinda, in it. Yeah. Tarantino written, at least.
Yeah.
And there's at least two bits in it where you go, well, that was obviously Tarantino, because it's fucking gross.
Yeah, he's something else, isn't he?
I assume at some point he's gonna get me too, didn't he? He's got to do it.
Yeah, yeah. Just like they're trying to do it now, Tropic Thunder, but...
We'll never talk about Tropic Thunder on this podcast. I fucking hate that bit. Anyway, what else could we have been talking about in 1996?
So, if our listeners want to know, they could listen to the Frighteners episode, but I'm going to go with some unsung heroes here. I've got Biodome.
Pauly Shaw. Kylie Minogue's in that question.
I think, yeah. Kingpin.
Oh, yeah, that's fun. Yeah.
Long Kiss Goodnight. Don't really like it.
Oh, the Samuel Jackson, Gina Davis thing.
Yep, that's the one.
Hey, Chris, why isn't Gina Davis in movies anymore?
Broken Arrow.
Broken Arrow's great fun.
Yeah, it's fun.
If you haven't seen Broken Arrow, listeners, what the fuck have you been doing? Why are you listening to this podcast?
I know.
But if you haven't seen Broken Arrow, there's a real kind of massive... 180, 360 thing at the like the 20-minute mark, isn't there? You don't expect.
Aye, you don't see it. You
like
don't
it
see
comes
it.
Out of nowhere, and then all of a sudden, it's like
it's something else.
Something else, yeah.
A bit like this film, and last but not least, The Phantom.
Billy Zane.
Billy Zane, yeah.
I have a mask, yeah. Super. So, shall we get started?
Let's crack on.
Fantastico. Right, we open with a Miramax film. We are not going to talk about them. We're not going to do it. At least I didn't think we were going to do it. And then I started looking at the Dimension films.
Here we go.
The horror and sci-fi arm of Miramax. We're not going to talk about that particular piece of shit, though, of course. So I'm not even going to say his name. First films were 1992's. How's this for a triple bill? Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth, the man that has sex while smoking. Children of the Corn 2, The Final Sacrifice, right? Which is not true, because they made another 9 of those flicks. There
and
is
they've got
11.
A reboot. There's a reboot coming.
Oh, including the reboot in that, yeah. Why must film titles lie to us, John? Why? Something I'd love to watch again. Fortress, starring your man Christopher Lambert.
That's amazing. That's,
is it? Oh, is it?
I loved it. Aye.
Okay. Oh, is it going on the list?
Yeah, it's got to be on the list, isn't it? It's got to be on the list.
So it opens at this liquor store in Texas, Benny's World of Liquor.
Yeah.
His tagline was, if we don't have it, you don't get it.
And it's on Route 86. This really,
Route 86.
This is weird because they're looking at Route 86. It stretches 90 miles and it only runs through the state of California.
Oh, you're looking at the wrong Route 86.
No, that's all right then.
There's a number of them. I think you're looking at the I-86. Scenic Route 86 is 149 miles east to west from Texaco, not the petrol station, but possibly also the petrol station, to Estillen, which I actually auto-changed to Enniskillen randomly. It opened in 1923.
Right, okay. That sounds more like it because I'm out of California.
It does sound a bit more like it, doesn't it? Sheriff Earl McGraw. Now, we know this character because he's in a couple of Tarantinos.
Hmm. There's a voice in it. There's a voice.
He's in Kill Bill as Sheriff Earl McGraw. And probably the best thing he's in because he keeps calling his deputy or son of mine or whatever. And that was kind of, where do I know that from? And I don't know it from anywhere. It's just some random way of talking. But I liked the character behind the counter.
Oh, Pete, he was great.
Pete Bottoms. Bottoms. He explains he ate lunch out the microwave. The sheriff says, it'll kill you faster than a bullet.
That really went.
That I couldn't find anything to suggest that microwave food was any more of a killer than other food. But I did find a lot of pages that said, contrary to what you might read on social media, microwaves are perfectly acceptable to have in your home and the microwave radiation will not kill you.
Oh, my God.
Obviously, there's people on the internet going, microwaves.
Yep, cancel it.
Absolutely.
Cancel the microwave.
Cancel the microwave. Press that little C button at the bottom. we learn that there's a bank job happened. The bank job's happened in Wichita, right?
Yep. Are we not going to go for the beginning monologue? No, we don't touch it.
What beginning monologue did we have that I missed?
The flipping burgers.
Oh, no. We are not. I've actually written here, you're right. The sheriff orders half a bottle of Jack, and there's a little bit about him getting unwell from food cooked by a...
Yeah.
Yeah, the only reason
I mentioned it is because Jack Daniels was founded in 1975 in Tennessee, but that's the only reason I was going to try and squeeze it in.
Oh, fantastic. Good work. No, there's a couple of really brutal terms here about a child with mental health issues, and then there's one later on about a homosexual slur, which we never use in this podcast, as listeners know. Wichita, it's mentioned that the geckos are heading from there. It's the largest city in Kansas. And home to 397,532 people, making it the 49th most populated city in the USA. Famous people from Wichita, John. Wyatt Earp was a lawman there. Local favourite, the BTK killer, Dennis Rader, was born, raised, and murdered people in Wichita. And of course, Wichita Lineman was written by Jimmy Webb and was a hit for Glen Campbell in 1968. It managed 10th in New Zealand, 7th in the UK, 3rd in the US, where it went gold, and 1st in Canada, There you go. It didn't seem to chart in any of our favourite European charts. Indeed. Three cops and some civilians have been killed, and a hostage has been taken. We'll come back to that later, because it gets really funny. There's a bit I just laughed at both sides as I was watching the movie. The sheriff heads to the toilet and Seth and Richard Gecko walk round the corner with two hostages. Of course, we've got Seth Gecko, who is?
George Clooney.
Gorgeous George.
Just to point this out, this is the first time I noticed him standing in the corner during the conversation. I never noticed him in the corner before.
No, neither did I. And I know he's in there. I know the character's in the shop, but I didn't know if you'd actually seen him.
You can see them. When he's walking to get his beer, you can actually see them in the corner, which leads me to question, how the hell did he know seen him when he went to the fridge to get that beer?
He comes in. His brother Richie's there, of course, Quentin Tarantino, who is never an actor as long as he's got a hole in his ass.
Oh man, he's bad. He's bad. There's a couple of nice wee bits in it when he's trying to pretend to be things, but aye, he's not.
Oh yeah. There's a, yeah, because I think that might be Quentin Tarantino? Question mark. He turns up and he says you signal the sheriff and I'm going to turn this place into the Wild Bunch. It's a great line. Benny says, look, he's always having conversations with the sheriff. It's just what he does. The Wild Bunch is a 1969, nice film. Sam Peckinpah directed. William Holden's gang get wiped out in a bloody shootout with bounty hunters. Mandalorians they may not be. So that's the reference. Yeah? It was nominated for original screenplay and score by the Academy. By the way, how fucking beautiful is George Clooney here?
Oh, man, that tattoo as well. Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah. So cool. Richie pulls him aside and whispers to Seth that Benny was giving him signals. Benny says, you asked me to act natural. Under the circumstances, I think I should be given an Academy Award. Fucking yes. Really good. The sheriff returns. As he's paying for the booze, Richie just out of nowhere unceremoniously shoots him in the back of the head. And explains Benny was signaling the sheriff. Benny dives for a gun in the safe and comes up shoots Richie in the hand. Seth comes out like going mad, isn't he? Going bam, 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 kind of thing. Gets Benny in the shoulder. And as Benny's reloading, he's going. He says, "What did you do that for?" He says, "I told you he was signaling the sheriff," and he's just screaming, "I was not signaling!"
He's so really funny. That's funny, isn't he?
He's great. And then he says, "Right, Richie, when I signal, you shoot the bottles of booze from behind the counter. The booze covers Benny, and Seth throws a lit toilet roll at him."
Aye, so goes, smooth where he gets the petrol off.
Yeah. Yeah, it's great. He goes up in flames, but he runs out shooting at them. So not only is he my favourite trope, a man on fire, but he's a man on fire trying to blow them away. Well into that. They leave the stores.
It's the popcorn. See when he lands on the ground and he's in fire, or he has popcorn popping around about him. Popcorn.
The store's exploding, and he's going, "How is this keeping a low profile?" It's good. We, of course, then get the titles.
Yeah. They speed away in a 1968 Mercury Cougar XR7.
Oh, super. Yeah.
It's a beautiful looking car as well.
It's gorgeous. Yeah. By the way, I've got to say, when this came out, I thought that Quentin Tarantino haircut, glasses, and granddad shirt combo was amazingly totally cool.
Oh, yes.
It is not.
It's not aged well at all.
No, really, if you wanted a granddad collar shirt, though, John, 12 quid on Boohoo Man.
That was one of the names. I had a few of them. I thought they were brilliant.
Here on the titles is Dark Knight by The Blasters. Master Blaster! 1985 song by The Blasters from the album Hardline. No chart details, but got a 2 out of 5 in the Rolling Stone album guide. Middle up road. In the titles, there's a mention that it's a Robert Kurtzman written job. And I was like, where do I know that name from? And it turns out I don't know that name from anything. He has done two things he's done loads that I know of because he's a special effects guy. So he's got over 80 features of stuff that he's done, usually like monsters and zombies and creatures and things like that. But this is the only thing he's ever written or got a writing credit for. And he's only ever directed one thing. Favourite of both of ours and 100% future episode for the list. The Wishmaster.
Oh, my God.
Which I assume means he made all those crazy kind of snake monsters and things at the beginning.
Yeah, it must have done. God, Wishmaster. We've seen that in years.
Wishmaster, I think, is definitely a future episode.
Because one of them has got a few villains in it. Like they had Michael Myers, the guy who plays Michael Myers in it. One of them had a few of them. I'm sure Robert England was cameo.
Robert England's in this one. He's the collector of the antiquities.
It might have been one of them, but they actually showed them without any time zone playing their characters.
Oh, right. Okay. Oh, right. Oh, that I didn't know. Maybe it is that one then. Yeah, maybe it is the first one. Richie's taping his hand up with this gaffer tape, and we see that they've got a woman bound in the boot of the car, which I thought was pretty good, even though she's blatantly not in that boot of that car. Pulling up to a motel, Seth gets impatient with this bell, and he's just like banging the bell, isn't he? And this old boy comes out, oh, what are you?
And he's like, listen, you old grumpy old bastard.
You mean old bastard? What do you think I want? I want a room. And then he goes, oh, okay, sir.
So that was a dewdrop at the hotel, wasn't it? So dewdrop. But there's no such thing, but there is a dewdrop in motel.
Oh, excellent. Okay. Good spot. Somewhere here in this list, I have got some hotels. I know I've got some hotels here somewhere, but it's somewhere hidden in my list that I will come to at some point because I can't find it just now. Richie's pissed off that the room doesn't have cable, an X-rated channel, or a water bed. And I was like, waterbeds? Is that what we're doing with your brother? waterbed, aqua style waterbeds.co.uk of Chorley, Lancashire, which is semi-local to me, offer a jazz waterbed. Love the mags, hate the music of the beds.
I was going to say that. Are you seeing that right?
It's got drawers under it, and it's £910 for a king size.
Oofed.
Yeah. This is where the... this is where they sit down the hostage, and he says to her what I said at the top of the show. He says, be like a plant. Plants don't talk. and he sits her down and says, look, she's called Gloria. And he says, look, you know, we've got rules. Rule number one, no noise. Or Mr. 42 here answers that.
which confused me because the only thing I can see is a Smith & Wesson Model 66, but I don't know if it's
right.
44.
Rule number two, see new rule number one. Rule number three, don't try and run or I have six bullets that can run faster. He promises as long as she follows the rules, she's going to be fine. He's heading out now and he asks Richie to watch Gloria. They have a little bit of a discussion about the money in the trunk. It says that they're heading to Mexico to hide. They're heading to El Rey. The price is 30%, but Richie wanted a better deal. Seth explains that's the price for being hidden out in Mexico.
Right. Do you know El Rey is an archaeological site of the pre-Columbian Mayan culture? It's located southwest of Mexico.
Did you know that, John? Yeah, I did know that. It's in Cancun.
Yeah.
There you go. The Mayans abandoned the site.
Sorry.
The Mayans pissed off when the Spaniards turned up, which we would all do.
God damn those Spaniards there.
Indeed. Anyone would think we weren't going on holiday there in the summer.
I know.
We cut to a diner where Harvey Keitel's Jacob is discussing with Scott and Kate, they're his children, that he wants a rest in a motel bed. They've got an RV bed, and that's okay, but it's not like a real bed. They take the piss out of him because obviously his point is that he's going to that's what they're going to stay in that. And he says, I want to sleep in a real bed. Very different to Bad Lieutenant here, John, wasn't he?
Mate, honestly, every time I think about that performance, it still makes me. It's a really gritty thing to watch.
Make your ass clinch a little bit.
It's horrible to watch, but you can't take your eyes off him. He's just so good at what he does.
And in this, he's very understated, playing John Hammond, of course. Yes, they bought an RV. They spared no expense. Scott goes to the loo, and Kate explains that the Baptist manager left a message on the answer phone saying that they wouldn't replace Jacob until he's back off of his trip. He explains he no longer wants to be a pastor. He doesn't believe in God enough anymore after his wife's death. Daddy, what do you think Mom would say? Nothing. Your mother is dead. I know. Fucking hell.
I know. I saw.
The American Baptist Churches, USA, were established as the Northern Baptist Convention in 1907 in Providence, Rhode Island. There are currently 5,025 congregations and more than 1.3 members across the United States of America.
Nice.
News report, and it's Kelly Preston, RIP, by the way. Keep forgetting she's dead. She explains the bank raid in Wichita and shows this brilliantly funny graphic of how many people are dead before. I like this sports scorecard. It just ticks up. She's like, and that and with three more people dead, it goes tick, tick, tick. That makes a total of 30 dead. But they show the picture of Earl McGraw, right, the sheriff, and then they show the picture of Pete Bottoms, and it's
simultaneous life, right? With the belly bass. I know, it's just so funny. It's such a big smile on his face as well.
Such a kick out of that. It doesn't even look like the same person, though, does it?
I know. He looks bigger than he.
He looks much older. Anyway, big kick out of that. Something else I got a huge kick out of course, was John Saxton. Not in this movie.
I know. I'm like, God, how many times does this guy need to play a cop or a bloody marshal or something?
He turns up as chief of the FBI or whatever he says. You're taking it very seriously. He has three lines, 30 seconds, and that's it. I can only assume that they must have driven to his house, picked him up, put him in a suit, put a bit of makeup on, and then just filmed it on like the steps of his local town hall.
Yeah, yeah.
And they just went, cheers, John, the check's in the post. Off he went. Get some Gabba Magool or something.
Back to Elm Street.
Indeed, yeah. John Saxon was proficient in archery due to his job during high school working at Coney Island Archery Concession. There you go.
Wow.
We've done John Saxon to fucking death now, but I had to find at least one fact about him.
That.
Yeah. Back at the motel, Seth's here with food, explaining they're going to go across the border.
Did you see what food it was?
No, I didn't.
No way.
No, go on.
A Kuna burger. It's a big Kuna burger.
Oh, man. I hear they got some tasty burgers. Fantastic.
Yeah. Big Kuna burger.
Yeah. Good reference. I assume at some point somebody smokes a red apple cigarette, but I didn't see that. He explains they're going across the border. When the hostage isn't in the room, Seth storms into the bedroom. And we see, this is really well shot, we see just flashes of the scene. So like blood-covered sheets, a bit of body, a bit of like tights or whatever. It's quite good filmmaking. Richie's like, oh, she tried to escape. She got really mouthy. What do you mean? She wouldn't say shit if she had it in her mouth.
Mouth full of it. I thought it was a brilliant line.
The assumption here is that he's raped and murdered Gloria. Seth loses his rag with his brother, demands he gets it together till they get over the border. We see the family RV pull up into the motel. It nearly hits Seth as he walks across.
A 1978 Fleetwood Pace RO27.
That's a great spot, John. Yeah. I couldn't find one for sale, but I did find a 1995 one for sale in Wyoming. $14,950 of your finest dollary dues.
Nice.
Okay. This is the bit where he says, it looks like a flop house. And he says, look, as long as it's got a bed, I don't care. Price of a motel on Route 86, John. We'll start at the bottom and we'll stay there. At the Executive Inn, $50 a night.
What?
So that's $40 a night too much. It looks like it was last decorated when this film was in production.
Wow.
Yeah, it's the kind of place you'd expect to find near a town called Muleshoe. Just outside Muleshoe. Okay.
And these people have ham radios and he's candy cane.
We did reference that on holiday and I can't remember why now. There was a candy cane reference. Later on, Jacob's woken up by Richie asking him for an ice bucket. He pulls his gun and Seth walks around the door frame. Of course, Jacob's like, what is this? He punches him and goes, it's called a punch. That's a good line. They hold guns on Jake and Scott as Kate comes in. Seth tells him to start the RV, but Richie's daydreaming about Juliette Lewis, basically asking him to go down on her. Which always made me feel a little bit sick because she's not 18 yet. Well, she's not 21 yet. We'll know in this because she says she can't drink because she's not 21. My assumption is that she's like 16 or 17 or something, and it's just gross. Actually, the actor was 23, so it's kind of okay.
Yeah, because she'd done that one with Woody Harrelson with Natural Born Killers.
Natural Born Killers and the one with California with Brad Pitt.
Oh God!
She went out with Brad Pitt. I had no idea about this, by the way, because I don't really care about who's dating who. But yeah, she dated Brad Pitt for 3 years.
Well,
yeah, pretty good. Yeah. Jacob's not having any of it. He pushes back on the kids being taken and says, just take me over the border. Seth threatens to kill all of them if they don't go together. In the RV, Richie's gun held on the kids in the back. He explains they're going to Mexico. What's in Mexico?
Mexicans. Oh, that still makes me laugh, man. I think I've used that a million times.
Me too. Seth shouts to Richie to put his bit in.
Yeah.
And he admits to grinding his teeth. Pack of five mouth guards for nighttime grinding, £16.98 with next day delivery from that awful website that I don't want anybody to shop at.
Yeah, grinder.
You'll know the one. Oh, by the way, on the subject of buying stuff, if you want to buy this kid's Precinct 13 t-shirt, $18 on replicaproppstore.com.
Oh, homage exactly to John Cameron to run it. They both love him, Robert Rodriguez. Yeah.
I
know, but I don't think they blatantly put it, because it had the same font and everything.
Yeah. Actually, that said, listeners, if you don't like John Carpenter, can you reach out to us? Because I'd really be interested to have a conversation with you. I'm not going to take the piss, I promise. I just really want to know how you can't like John Carpenter films, I think.
Yeah, it blows my mind.
Yeah. Talking up the front, we learn that Jacob's wife died in an auto wreck. Trapped in the wreck for 6 hours before she died. Oh, those acts of God really stick it in and break it off. Is a term I used to use all the time when this film came out, and I haven't thought about it for years. An act of God is defined as any accident or event that is not influenced by man. For insurance purposes, a simpler way to put it is events that occur through natural causes and could not be avoided through the use of caution and preventative measures. In essence, the phrase refers to natural disasters.
Cool. And insurance claims?
Yeah, fucking insurance. Seth explains that if he gets them into Mexico, he'll keep Richie off Kate. You saw the way he was looking at her, yeah? Well, I'll keep him off him. Yeah, well, if you don't, I'm going to kill him. And that's fine, but I'll kill each and every one of you. It's kind of like, all right, this back and forth. In the back, Richie's eyeing up Kate, and this is... Oh, the lingering shots on her feet. Oh, man. Maybe BuzzFeed will pay me to write an article on a top 10 of the women's feet in Tarantino films. Do you know what I mean? Because they've all got bits, and obviously Juliette Lewis's will be somewhere near the top. Uma Thurman's monkey claws will be somewhere at the bottom
at your bottom.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry, you're fantastic, but your feet, man, sort them out. Lieutenant Dan wouldn't have any of those feet.
Ding, ding.
Richie asks if she meant what she said in the room, and she obviously has no idea what he means because he's got problems. And there's this bit: he's that Richie. I told you to watch those kids, not have a conversation with them. And he's like, and he goes, "We'll talk later." And the look that she gives him is kind of like it's like this really confused, pitiful kind of look.
Then she starts looking everywhere, but
do you know what? If you need proof, because I don't think you do. Juliette Lewis is a fine actor, right? But this was good. This was good. Just something about just doing, saying nothing and just like, yeah, fantastic. At the border crossing, Scott gets up front and Richie, Kate and Seth hide in the bathroom. Right? Mm. Here, of course, we see Cheech Marin in his first of three roles.
Yep.
Border inspection guard this time. Jacob explains, just the two of us. I'm taking my son for education to see his first bullfight. And I was like, fuck you.
Yeah. Do you know there's a toll for that?
All right, to get it to Mexico.
$25.
$25? That seems like just taking money for nothing.
I don't know if that's just tourists, because it says tourists, but it just doesn't mention categorically.
$25 to get out. $700 to get back in.
Aye.
unless you've got a door. I for one, as an island nation, welcome all comers. If anybody tells me that we should be blowing up this word, small boats, let's blow up small boats. No, fuck off. Let them in. If they're willing to go on a fucking door across treacherous weather and things, let them in. Do you know what I mean? What are you bringing to society?
And how many times did little boats help you win battleships?
They always sacked the rewinds.
Yeah.
In the toilet, Seth explained to Richie, as long as he doesn't act like a nut, we'll be fine. Richie starts losing his rag and hits the wall. Oscar Marin is the name of the character. Hears this. Oscar Marin was named, of course, after Cheech Marin's dad. Seth knocks Richie out and Kate poses on the toilet as the border guard opens the door. Because she's like, oh, I'm in here. The door's open. Yeah. And then he opens the door and she's like, hey, what did you expect?
Close the fucking door.
But then he lingers.
Lingers, I know.
It really creeped me out. It was really horrible. they get through and, of course, head to a bar. Where do they go, John?
The Titty Twister.
The Titty Twister, absolutely. Yeah. There are 50 places you can cross the border. There you go. Legally. I mean, I'm sure there's loads of places with that half-done wall. You're going to build half a wall.
Do you know what I found weird? I was looking up El Paso, but I didn't know El Paso was in Texas.
I
thought it was in Mexico.
All right, okay. Definitely in Texas.
Also, they mentioned somewhere called Big Springs, right? So I looked up.
Yeah.
So
That's where the shop is. That's where the liquor shop was, yeah.
So Big Springs is a nice town in the west of Texas in the middle of oil field country. Uh-huh. Where there's not a lot of options for entertainment, food, or shopping, what we have is good. That's it.
Oh, fucking bravo.
That's fucking brilliant, isn't it? What we have is good.
Big Springs, fuck me.
No food, no entertainment. And there's a college there as well, so don't know what the bloody students do.
Really funny you should mention that, because there's a throwaway line about Abilene, Texas. And I couldn't find, even on my second view, because on my listeners, just to give you an idea about what I do, on the first view, and I make a note of the things I'm going to look up. And then on the second viewing, I do the long notes. But I couldn't find on the second viewing where Abilene, Texas is mentioned. But Abilene, Texas was settled in 1881, is the largest employer there, is the Dyess Air Force Base. And Abilene is home to three Christian universities. Abilene Christian University, McMurray University, and my favourite, Hardon-Simmons University.
What?
But I'll be honest, that city sounds like the worst night out I could possibly imagine, y'all. Air Force boys and Christians. Oh, I mean, Jesus. Sort your fucking lives out, mate.
That's a party right there.
No wonder they're being hard on Simmons.
Should they erect a statue?
Hey! There's one of the other things I noticed on the outside was an advert here. And there was a few things like tequila and whatever. We've done tequila about 100 times. But one of them was carnitas.
As soon as I seen it, I thought, oh, what is that? And I looked up as well. What did you get? So I've got it as a Mexican version of pulled pork, but it literally means little meats.
It does, yeah. Slow cooked pork. Good work. Yeah. Fantastic. We get the second performance for Cheech. He's back very quick. And his character, do you see what his character's called?
Oh, Pussy. Something
Chet
Pussy.
Chet Pussy.
That's what it is. Chet Pussy.
And I'll do it, although I hate myself for it. All right, Pussy. Come on in, Pussy lovers. Here at the Titty Twister, we're slashing Pussy in half. Give us an offer on our vast selection of Pussy. This is a Pussy blowout. All right, we got white Pussy, black Pussy, Spanish Pussy, yellow Pussy. We got hot Pussy, cold Pussy. We got wet Pussy. We got smelly Pussy. We got hairy Pussy, bloody Pussy. We got snapping Pussy. You did the movements, John. I like it.
Love that. We got
silk Pussy, velvet Pussy, nahog-eyed Pussy. We even got horse Pussy, dog Pussy, chicken Pussy. Come on in. You want Pussy? Come on in, Pussy lovers. If we don't got it, you don't want it. Come on in, Pussy lovers. And there's a bit of chat. And then again, he says, attention, Pussy shoppers. Take advantage of our penny Pussy sale. If you buy one piece of Pussy at the regular price, you get another piece of Pussy of equal or lesser value for only a penny. Try and beat Pussy for a penny. If you can find cheaper Pussy anywhere,
fuck it. Fucking love it, man.
And it's It's awful. Like,
it's terrible.
It is the most 90s thing I think I can remember. It's up there with, oh, I don't know, fucking Spawn.
Oh, no.
Do you know what I mean? It's atrocious. Yeah. But it's still kind of good. But my question to you, John, is, right, what of those... I know we've got female listeners, and I'm kind of sorry. Right? What of those types of pussy, John, are equal value? So, what, you know, of all those, I mean, is chicken pussy equal to velvet pussy?
Wow. I'm going to need to have a think about that, because I'm sure there must be some way of adding them up. Or see what one you want for the penny.
Lesser value. Absolutely. Anyway, fucking hell.
It's descended, man.
It's brutal. he tries to stop them going in. Seth twists his arm, literally twists his arm, and punches him before Richie kicks him while he's down, giving it the, how are you? Are you having a good night? It's quite good. And eventually knocks him out.
Yeah.
Inside the place, there's a band. I love the band. Strippers. Aye. And I've written here a young Danny Trejo behind the bar, but
oh god, he really is. Though. He's always been old, though. But
younger. Covers. Yeah. I love the fact when he turns into a vampire later, he looks like Danny Trejo looks like now.
They got him. They seen it coming.
He refuses them service because it's a biker and trucker bar. Now Jake comes into his own for the first time here. Well, not for the first time because he got them over the border. But he explains that he drives the RV. And for that, you need a trucker's license because it's a class 2 vehicle. He's a trucker, and these are my friends. That works for the barman. A class 2 driver is qualified to drive a truck over 3,500 kilos, including a trailer weighing up to 750 kilos in the UK.
Mate, okay.
See?
I'll buy that for a dollar.
Well, you see, John, you can implement more borders, but you can't get rid of kilos that you're driving in a fucking trailer, can you? Stupid old gammony bastards. I love this line. I love that. He buys tequila, a couple of bottles of tequila and some beers. And he says, hey, you serve food here, Jose? And he goes, the best in Mexico. And he goes,
I doubt that.
It's a fun line, and Jose looks furious. But it made me think, because the advert for those old El Paso Mexican meal kits in the UK, it's your man Danny Trejo does the voiceover for that.
Oh, does he?
Yeah. Yeah, if you've seen old El Paso
advert, he does,
it's Danny Trejo doing it, yeah.
As soon as I started seeing him at old El Paso, I'm like, hang on a minute.
Yeah, other Mexican actors are available, I'm led to believe.
Yeah.
We see the other patrons, the brilliant sex machine, with his whip and his crotch gun. Tom Savini, by the way, I think might be the coolest nerd on the planet.
Yeah, without a doubt.
We love Tom Savini. We've done a number of Tom Savini.
Yeah, original Donnie the Dead is Baker. Happy Days.
Yeah, and he did all the... He basically did all of Romero's zombie films, did all the work on those.
Yeah, yeah.
And directed the remake. Did you ever see the remake of Night of the Living Dead? It's Tony Todd.
I really enjoyed that.
I think it's really good. It's really adeptly directed. Enjoyed it. Yeah, and that's Tom Savini.
They've done well with it.
He made the crotch gun himself.
It was in El Mariachi as well, or one of the Desperados. Desperado 2.
Yeah, it is. He's great. He's fantastic. And Frost, who we'll come to. We'll come to Frost. Because Frost is the best and worst character.
It really is.
The most 2D character in the whole thing.
Oh, I think the reason they done one of these features in it was just to try and take advantage of that fact. To be honest,
they just wanted Fred Williamson in a film. just do what you usually do, and he's like, absolutely. The geckos get Kate and Scott drinking, and the barman gets up and introduces Satanico Pandemonium.
Yeah.
Satanico Pandemonium, named after a 1970s Mexican horror flick about a nun who fantasizes about getting it on with the devil.
Nice.
But don't we all? Don't we all?
Exactly.
Yeah. Now, of course, John, I've very little doubt. Selma Hayek here, dancing in her scants with an albino boa constrictor. Now, of course, I'm going to be talking about the dance. Yes. I'm going to be talking about the panties. The I'm going to be talking about that hot belly. No. Here's some facts about the snake. Right.
I stopped taking notes at this point, so this is all you, buddy.
So here's some facts about the snake. The albino Burmese python is native to the large area of Southeast Asia and is listed as vulnerable on the UCN Red List.
Oh, yeah. Jesus.
Between 1996 and 2006, I love this, the Burmese python gained popularity in the pet trade with more than 90,000 snakes imported into the US. You think that's good? It gets better. The current number of Burmese pythons in the Florida Everglades may have reached what is known as a minimum viable population, which makes them an invasive species.
Oh, man.
Hurricane Andrew in 1992 was deemed responsible for the destruction of a python breeding facility and zoo, and these escaped snakes spread and populated areas into the Everglades. More than 1,330 have been captured.
Bloody
hell. How cool and horrifying is that? I love that. So I've got nothing on Salma Hayek being, being young and hot, but she is.
Oh, I've got more than a snake. The largest one recorded in history was 26.5 feet and weighed over 500 pounds.
Oh, excellent.
That was a biggie. The only thing I've got on Salma Hayek is she had this fear and phobia of snakes and took 2 months to seek therapy because Robert Rodriguez carried on that Madonna was ready to take
That's part. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And she was like, I'm not missing this. And we've known her ever since. Of course, I think this is her second best dancing role behind Candy Girl in the strip club in Dogma that we did as a previous episode.
Oh, yeah. But she also done a bit in Desperado as well.
Yeah. Man, those are such good films, by the way. Have you seen El Mariachi?
Yeah, the original one.
That's brilliant.
I love them.
I love El Mariachi.
And she didn't use a choreographer for the dancing because she couldn't predict what the snake was going to do, so she just done it all herself. So well done,
at a girl, fantastic.
Recommended, yeah.
Of course, Quentin Tarantino writes a bit into the script where he can basically just eat her foot.
Yeah, why not? Why not?
Okay. Perks of the job? ? But you know what leads to Miramax problems.
I say Clooney got a better deal as well, but he was right behind her. It looked a bit awkward, but he was right behind her when she was dancing.
The show ends and the place goes absolutely nuts. Just then, Chet Pussy arrives with the barman and these heavies, including possibly the heaviest looking actor I've ever seen.
Fucking big boy, isn't he?
He looks like late in life Orson Welles, doesn't he? I almost expected him to be a fucking planet eating fucking cybertronic creature.
That is a big piece, isn't he?
He points out the geckos and the barman stabs Richie in the hand, which starts to bleed. They kill the barman and Chet and the big lad. We see Santanico basically drooling over the hand. She jumps on Richie's back and bites his neck, turns into a vampire, which the first time I saw this, I didn't know this was a vampire flick, by the way, and this blew me away. I had no idea what this was. Yeah. I watched this with my old man, and I think he might have gone at the time, bloody hell!
Yeah, it was a surprise to everybody, to be honest.
Yeah. The place goes mad. The patrons are all ripped apart. The dancers have all their faces just changed to become vampires. The makeup looks fantastic. Greg Nicotero stuff. Yeah.
The guitar.
The band changes into and it's they're playing a new song and the guitar is like body parts, isn't it? It's like a torso and an arm.
A head and a leg. Yeah. Oh, it's weird.
Seth shoots Santanico and holds Richie in his arms as he dies. The heavies all rise up as vampires. The place is going crazy. Chet is about to bite Kate when she shoves her little cross around her neck into his mouth and he melts. It looks good.
Great. It looks like a bit of stop motion at first, but then it just falls off.
Yeah,
so that was quite good.
It was. Frost flips a table and drops a vampire dancer on each of the legs. It looks great. Shot from above, you see them all angled. It looks fantastic.
Flailing. Good.
Sex machines killing vampire broads on a pool table. The barman comes at him after ripping this poor bloke's arm off, and Rachel went, "He's got an arm off!" sex machine throws the barman a pool cue, which confuses him, and then whips his feet together, drags him off them onto his back, jumps up, grabs the pool cue, breaks it against him, puts it through his chest. And as he burns away, his eyeballs roll into opposite pockets.
I don't think I noticed that. I thought what had happened was in my head, because I can remember the scene, but I can remember pool balls going into pockets. So I thought that he had, maybe it was back in the day, because I watched it in HD, whereas it was back in terrestrial TV days. I thought there was pool balls already on the table.
Ah, right.
Okay. Him flattening his hand in, so no, it's his eyeballs.
Got you.
Look at the eyeballs.
It's really cute. I like it. Savini did all his own whip stunts because he's proficient. Oh. He's proficient in whip work. Let's call it whip work. Licorice whip. Meanwhile, Pandemonium threatens to make a slave of Seth. No thanks. I've already been married. It's great.
That's a good line.
He knocks it at the ground and shoots a massive chandelier off the roof, which flattens her and kills her.
Improved that line.
Oh,
apparently.
Was it really? Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Apparently, Rodriguez didn't want it in, but they kept it in.
Oh, it's in the trailer. They put it in the trailer, and he's like, "Now I've got to put it in the movie." Thanks. Frost punches the heart out of the massive goon. He basically says, "Whoa!" doesn't he? Which is obviously his kung fu movie background stuff. And the goon continues walking and kind of fighting people. Sex machine comes across and just puts a pencil through it. It just falls to the ground dead. It's great. Good. The final four dancers are here, and we've got Seth, Jacob, Sex Machine, and Frost taking them down. And the kids try the doors, but they're locked, so they can't get out. They turn around. "Now let's kill that fucking band."
"Thank you, everyone. Good night."
"No, fuck you, everybody. Good night." And then they explode.
Did they? I thought it just disappeared.
No, they explode because there's bits everywhere. And I was like, cowards.
I know.
Yeah. Seth finds Richie's body and tells him he's sorry he didn't do more. Richie jumps up and attacks him, and Seth stakes him. "Here is the peace in death I could not give you in life." It's quite a good line. It's a bit clunky.
Do you think Richie looked like? They obviously had an aesthetic for the vampire in the film later on. You see them, but you don't think like Richie's the only one that looked like something out of Evil Dead.
I'd actually written here. He looks like the love child of Fred Gwynne as Herman Munster, and your man. Viggo, the Carpathian. You know when Viggo goes all monstrous? There's a couple of different. There's one that has, you know, that bat that's got like the shitty, the boxer's nose flattened across its face. There's a couple of dancers have got like a split down their face.
Well, apparently there's four different variations because you could only afford four proper. Like, see the ones at the end, towards the end where you see them flying in?
Yeah, like the Nosferatu ones.
But apparently there's only four outfits you could make, so it's all...
Okay, so they've got four moulds and they've just done... Monster. Seth proceeds to start drinking, but Jacob explains they need him sober. We hear bats outside. Bat! And hundreds of them clamouring to get in. Kate and Sex Machine head to state the ex-patrons, which have all now started to turn. She can't bring herself to do it. She's looking at him because he just looks so peaceful and dead. Yeah. She can't, and this is some good acting as well. Sex Machine sees her do it finally, gives her a smile, but he's taking his eye off the ball and he gets his arm bitten. And we're about to see some of the finest acting in the whole film from Savini, by the way. The remaining humans get together and discuss how they can defeat the vampires. Scott suggests crosses. Put two sticks together and make a cross. Sex machine. Yeah, Peter Cushing does it all the time.
Big fan, though. He's a big fan.
Really, really sweet line. Peter Cushing, of course, played Van Helsing.
Van Helsing.
Five times in five different films. Or versions of Van Helsing in five different films.
Fucking legend, man. Absolute legend.
Absolutely. They talk about garlic, sunlight, holy water. They argue over silver. And Kate says, has anyone got any silver? No. Well, it doesn't fucking matter. which is quite good. I really liked that. And Jacob says, has anyone actually read a book? Like a real book? And Sex Machine says, you mean like a Time Life book? Got to kick out that. We've done Time Life at least once already. Of course, you all know them, listeners, magazines, videos, and books by post. They stopped doing books in 2001. Titles that your old American dar would absolutely get a kick out of. The American Story. Echoes of Glory. Classics of WWDo. The Civil War. Which, by the way, I was looking at this, The Civil War, I found it on eBay. 28 volumes. 28 Jesus. Fucking books. Get out. Get out. How much Civil War could you have? too much is what I say.
Yeah, no half.
Seth explains that Jacob's the best weapon they have, but he needs to keep his faith. He says, you know, are you a motherfucking weapon of God? We need you to be a motherfucking weapon of God. And he goes, I am a weapon of God. Like, he won't say the line. He won't say the swears. Even up until the end. Kate explains she can't take any more of the bat's noise. Frost explains, you can because you have to. I was in Nam. I remember when I first saw this, I was like, I know this is a Vietnam. I've seen it so many times. And it's the one kind of bit I've always been so proud of myself knowing he was going to say, I was in Nam. And I was like, this fucking story, man. He's talking about how the VC wiped out his whole platoon. And he just lies under the bodies. And a grenade goes off. It's why I'm so pretty. But we miss most of it, because this is when Sex Machine starts hearing voices.
It starts to change,
Sex Machine, kill everyone! he notices his teeth.
His fangs, and then his hands.
And this brilliant, because he puts his hand over his mouth. I was going to do it, but it doesn't make for very good podcasting. Puts his hand over his mouth, and then the hand goes all wizened. And then he puts them behind his back, and Scott turns around to look, and he gives this wide-eyed kind of, I'm listening. Look, it's fucking brilliant.
It's class, isn't it?
And then we go back to Frost's story. When I came to my senses, I realized I'd killed the entire VC squad, single-handed. There were chunks of blood and yellow flesh on my bayonet, and this Sex Machine just comes up behind him. Bites him. Takes on everybody. This bit, Frost goes like really high pitched. He fucking bit me.
I know.
I was like, I think that's ADR.
Come on, Sex Machine.
I do. Come on, Sex Machine. All the time. All the time. Just apropos of nothing. If I'm about to do something in my head, I'll go, come on, Sex Machine. Just apropos of nout, right? Frost throws Sex Machine through the door, making a hole big enough for all the bats to stream in. And then Frost changes. And I love Frost makeup because he's got no neck. He goes from having... Did you ever have a Wii, John?
Yes.
Yeah. Did you ever make a Mii and one of the Mii's had like a bell-shaped face?
Yeah.
It looks like that. And I think that particular big fat Wii was modelled after Frost. Frost versus Nixon in this. The kids and Seth run to a back room and lock themselves in. Jacob's seen covering up his bike behind the bar. He grabs a shotgun and a pool cue and uses them as a cross to get back to the room. Mm-hmm. Every now and again, reloading and just shooting them in the face.
Yeah, it's brilliant, isn't it? Yeah. It's a brilliant...
He explains to them he's been bit, but he's able to help for now at least. And now we find out what's in the boxes with them. Turns out that the guys have been, the owners and the vampires have been taking over trucks and whatever and keeping whatever's in there. And now we get an A-team montage.
Oh, yeah, yeah, this is it. Yep. Fantastic. Somebody's got a jackhammer, the other person's got squishy guns,
everything.
Glasses.
Yeah, absolutely everything. The A-Team John ran for 5 seasons and 98 episodes between 1983 and 1987. And my fact of the episode, in the pilot, Face was played by a guy called Tim Dunnigan. The network wanted him over Dirk Benedict. Dirk Benedict got the role full-time when he went to series. Otherwise, the producers weren't going to make it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Tim Dunnigan is a man who's been on a few things like The Fall Guy, stuff like that.
Right. So he's literally the unknown stuntman.
As good as I am for Tim. Yeah. As good as I am for Tim, all I can think of, you probably think that's a picture of my family. It's not. It's the A-Team. Bodie, Doyle, Tiger, the Jewelry Man. Which is a reference for absolutely nobody.
Still love it, though.
I do still love it, yeah. A little bit on Fred Williams. Williamson, by the way, never starred in a Vietnam War film, but he's in MASH, which is set during the Korean War, and the original Inglourious Bastards, which, of course, we all know is World War II. Fred Williamson, by the way, won the AFL Championship with the Kansas City Chiefs.
Jesus.
In 1966. Well, say the line, John.
Back when England had a good team.
That's right, yeah. And not the last time the Chiefs had a team, of course, because they won the Superb Owl earlier this month. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, absolutely. That's yeah, indeed. Fred Williamson, legend, and I know Joe is listening, and James might be listening. Perhaps we should do a Fred Williamson film on Hallmark After Dark, please. Last Orders. I keep calling it After Dark. Hallmark Last Orders. I know what it's fucking called. I've been listening to
you
it.
You keep thinking about Hollyoaks, didn't you?
I'm always thinking about Hollyoaks. I'm always thinking about Hollyoaks car crashes, which there isn't one of in this film. So, Jacob blesses some water, and they fill some Johnnies and Super Soakers with this water.
Yeah. It's a good effect, though.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And this is how you know that they're Baptists and not Catholics, because, of course, Catholics won't use prophylactics. and that's okay. That's okay.
Yep.
You do what you fucking want, mate. Just don't tell me what to do. Seth has this huge power drill that you've mentioned. He puts a massive stake in it. It's brutal. It is the best weapon they've got. Kate finds a crossbow, and they basically blast the way out, taking down some vamps. Sex Machine's here with his whip, right? Seth manages, whips Seth, or Seth grabs it and whips it around his neck and pulls his head off. Now, this made no sense to me because he grows into this giant rat beast.
Yeah.
Like,
that was weird.
The only connection I could make between bats and rats, other than the fact they're both mammals, was that film Night Shift. Do you remember that? The Stephen
Is that
King
the German?
One.
Oh, right.
The Stephen King one, where they go down in the basement to clear out the...
and there's a big massive...
And it's like rat bats. Yeah. Was it a reference to that? I don't know. Not to be confused with the Night Shift film starring Henry Winkler and Michael Keaton. You know, where they're working the morgue.
Yeah.
I remember that very fondly. I'm pretty sure that's shit.
I'm sure that's a cheery one.
Kate blasts it in the face with a bolt, and for some reason it explodes. Oh, they put crosses on the bolts, haven't they?
Yeah.
Scott gets bitten by his old man, who's now a vampire. And it looks really weird because he's still got like the little scraggly beard.
Yeah, that's a flesh coming up as well, which is a bit weird.
Hoys a Johnny full of holy water at his face before shooting what's left of him. But this half a face effect here,
It was great. It was really, really good.
Scott
see all the everything moving about inside when he was trying to.
Scott starts to get pulled apart by vamps, and he just begs her to kill him. And when she shoots him, basically.
In the holy water?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm assuming so.
Yeah. And that's why they all explode around him, kind of thing.
Yeah.
At this point, there's a hole in the wall or in the door, and we can see the light streaming through, and the vampires won't go near it. So they make the decision. Yeah. There's only two of them left. There's only Seth and Kate left, and they make the decision to blow holes in the door. And we hear Cheech's other character in outside. And he says, are you in there? He says, yeah, blast open the door. And as they're shooting through the door, the light's obviously burning them. And then the lights, out of absolutely nowhere, hits this Glitterball.
Mirrorball, yep.
Yeah, which we've done. We've done them already. And we've I couldn't figure out if it was the full Monty or not. Rachel seems to think it might have been the full Monty we did it.
It could have been actually, sure.
But what I will say is that our next episode, we'll be doing Glitterballs as well. At least once. At least once.
Okay.
Yeah. And obviously they all then start to explode. They head out into the day.
Into the dessert.
Yeah, into the dessert indeed. Cheech Marin's there. And he says
he punches him in the face, didn't he?
Yeah, he says what's going on in there? He says and you left us to vampires. Vampires, I thought they were just psychos. He says psychos don't explode no matter how crazy they when sunlight hits them, no matter how crazy they are. It's a great line. Yeah. He says, why did you pick this place? And he says, oh, one place is just as good as another.
Yeah, it's like, and it's open from dusk till dawn. Like,
and we all went, bah, bah, bah. You says the title, you wins the movie.
Win the prize. so he negotiates his deal.
Yeah, and he mentioned earlier that you can't negotiate. You can't argue with it. And he argues them down. He says, come and get a cold beer. He says, I've got foreign and domestic. And Mexican. I was kind of like, why would you want American beer when you drink Mexican beer?
But he walks away from him and he says, is it chingalo?
Yeah, he does, yeah.
Chingalo. Spanish for fuck it.
All right, okay, nice one. Kate wants to go with him and he's like, no, look, I'm going to El Rey. You don't want to be with me. Take the RV and away you go. And
she does.
And away they go. And that's the end of the movie.
And you get to see what's behind the pump.
Oh, wow. By the way, right, the zoom out here, the matte painting at the end is the only bit I thought looked like it had aged badly.
It was badly. But
it still looks good.
Ah, yeah, this wreckage run about it. If you squint, it looks really good.
Yeah, it does. But for a film that's nearly 30 years old, you can't fucking argue, really. Let's be fair.
So it has a Mayan temple in it?
It is, yeah. It's, again, another one of the ruins. We've talked about El Rey, and that's where we're going to kind of go. Any more for Hacked?
Right, just a three or four. So the origins of the tequila date back to 250 to 300 AD, where Aztec Indians first fermented juices produced for ceremonial wine.
Mm.
If you were to sever a major artery, you would bleed out within 3 minutes.
Okay.
I don't know why I've got that. Maybe it's because I've seen somebody getting bitten, blood squashing everywhere. Vlad the Impaler, or Vlad Dracul, allegedly killed over 300,000 people at the one time. So nice. I don't know how he managed to do that. The most expensive cigar in the world is $1 million.
Oh.
And the earliest representation of the crossbow dates back to 400 BCE.
Fantastic work, John. Super. And I'm out, you know. Oh,
what?
Cold cocking a gun. He mentions cold cocking the gun because he's out of bullets. Cold cocking is knocking someone out with a blow to the head.
Cool. Yeah, I remember that. Sorry, cold cocking. Yeah.
How many do you think we got?
It was a really short film, and I'm going to say 79.
Oh, you can go a little bit higher than that.
82.
85.
Hey.
Pretty good.
That was all right.
Pretty.
Because let's say once you walk into that bar, it's really hard to get fast because really all. But no, it was good. I thoroughly enjoyed it though.
Yeah. Oh, so did I, mate. Absolutely. So.
Yeah. As of its time, but I really enjoyed it.
Okay. How about some patron shout outs?
If you need to.
Yeah, these are the people that have paid us £1 a month, so they get a shout out. Loads of them have got stuff to advertise, actually. Joe from Hallmark of Greatness, we've already mentioned him. Because I've been away, he and James got mono on to talk about Sword and the Sorcerer this week. It is yikes for a film. Yeah. On the subject of yikes, Mono and Kira are talking Human Centipede on their own podcast.
Oh, God.
So my question for you, John, is where would you be in a Human Centipede with Mono and Kira?
Oh, God. No, my luck. I'd be at the right in the back.
Behind Mono.
No, behind fucking Mono's cat. No, my luck.
you and nine cats. The Belsons, be there with Belson podcast. Dan's been painting the town red and Gavin's been getting all isolated and weird.
Oh, man. I've had to give Kirsty my Belson's t-shirt.
Oh, have you?
It must have shrunk because it's tiny.
Must have shrunk, or you've been eating too many pies.
That's probably it. But no, Custy's. It actually sits better on Custy than it does me. So
get a picture for the socials.
I will do it.
This week on Modern Escapism, Stig, Biggie and Gadget, and that other bloody pair who don't give us any money, have written one another's Tinder bios. I'm going to be honest, it's gross and I'm a little bit jealous.
Oh.
Yeah, why have they not written anything for me? Punk from What the Fuck Do You Want? Apparently still not received his hat, John.
Oh, you're fucking kidding me, man.
Yeah, that's what happens when you try and send stuff to fucking Northern Ireland. But on the plus side, he can still get fresh fruit and vegetables in the supermarket. So I guess it swings and roundabouts, isn't it?
True. Yeah. What does it say? An apple for a hat and a hat for a...
Yeah, give us three tomatoes for that hat, you prick. Anyway, he's got Ian on from Cult Connections this week talking about blue tick pricks on Twitter. I love the fact that all these people, I think we connected all these people, by the way, pretty much.
And they're just, it's grams and legs, and they've just run off into the field.
Feed off one another in such a second. Yeah, creating our own little fucking mutant babies, six-toed fucking freaks.
Let's get them into the biodome. Yeah.
Over on Ian's Cult Connections, of course. Ian starting Mandalorian Series 3 this week with Maria, or Uncle Ian and Aunt Maru, as I've started calling them. He doesn't like that, and I'm sure she would like it less. I hope she didn't know. It seems a bit harsh. Josh and Amanda, super familiar with the Wilsons, of telling people this week how they're going to fix the world in the whole season. And this week, they're fixing having a cold, apparently.
Having
a cold, yeah.
I'll tune in once they do the man flu thing. Yeah, I can handle the cold.
Nigel wants to sell you tabletop models and gear and also not pay for his parking. But that's a bit of a private thing. SP Film viewers are saying, oh, hi, Mark, in the room this week.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Cheeky. Yeah. You're my favourite customer. Rachel has always helped me with the research. Thank you, my love. And Gav, Emily, Phil and Ian round off the lovely humans that don't have anything to advertise but are all in our Facebook group, listeners. Search 100 Things We Learned From Film group or 100 Things We Learned From Film, and it is the rainbow logo with a picture of John on it. That's where you'll find us doing regular memes and chat and things like that. It's a nice way to kind of share the film and TV memes that you like, and we love seeing them, and I tend to share them on my feed as well. So yeah, get in that Facebook group if you still do Facebook. I'm led to believe some people do. All the people that we mentioned there pretty much are in that group, so join us there for a bit of a laugh,
bit of a hoot.
Absolutely. Just one further bit of housekeeping, listeners. We, for the next couple of months, have got a lot on, so we have made the very, very difficult decision to can the podcast completely. to go to once a fortnight. We're going to once a fortnight just for a couple of months while we get shit in. I've put a lot of weight on holiday. I need to get back to the gym.
Yeah.
Work's pretty busy. You've got a fucking wedding to prepare for.
Yeah.
So we've got loads and loads going on. So we are so grateful for the support you've given us. This is not a reflection on what you did. It's just a reflection on how busy our lives are and how long this fucking process takes from start to finish.
We'll make sure that it's definitely quality over quantity. Then.
Absolutely. Yeah, we should be getting 100 for every film.
Definitely.
It's going to be that way. So anyway, it is what it is. Listeners, thanks so much. John, final words for the next 2 weeks?
Oh, it's going to be weird. No doing this every week now, so I'm going to miss it. But as I say, we will put everything into the episodes that we do. So thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So he's been John, I've been Planty, and this has been 85 Things We Learned From Dusk Till Dawn. Does that work? We've learned from Dusk Till Dawn. Either way. Fuck you and good night.
Fuck you. See ya.